Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the NYU. My name is Bilyana. I'm a fellow at the Information Law Institute and an assistant professor of international and European law in the Netherlands. So Ira and I had thought about this conference at a particular juncture in time. Obviously, with the election of Donald Trump and the ensuing gloom and doom in many different fields, among them the privacy one, we turn our gaze to states and localities. So can cities and localities actually do something to push back against this administration? Staying away from the political and more on the conceptual level, federalism and localism scholars have long been interested in the potential for bottom-up innovation and experimentation in other areas of the law, whereas the privacy one has gone somewhat under the radar, we think. So can we actually start to think of privacy as an essential mechanism of urban policy? How can cities and localities use big data effectively? So these are some of the questions we are going to try and tackle today. Then I'll just maybe pass the floor to Ira to say a couple of words about the conference.
Thank you, and let me also welcome all of you to NYU and to this conference. I think we've assembled a really terrific group of scholars, many of whom don't often get together because we have a nice mix of people from local government with a focus on localism issues, but also some federalism scholars, a number of privacy scholars from different fields, people both from academia and from advocacy groups and from city governments. So I think it'll be a very rich conversation. And with that, I think we'll just get started with the first panel. The bathrooms are outside on the other side of the lobby. There'll be a couple of coffee breaks in the course of the day. Lunch, I think, will be out there, and there'll be some tables where you can sit or just wander around. And if there are any other logistics questions, you can
Ask Nicole Arts, who is actually our right and left hand, and that we wish to thank also very much for making this possible. All right, so I'd like to briefly introduce our speakers. Nestor Davidson is the founder and director of the Urban Law Center at Fordham University. Nestor has published extensively on land use, housing and property law, and should be familiar to this crowd, especially for his work, his fascinating work on the sharing economy. So next to Nestor is Kathleen Morris, who is an associate professor at Golden Gate. And she's also published a lot on localism, but is also someone who has litigation experience on the local level that is very valuable, I think. That's something very valuable to bring on table, to the table. So finally, Ira Rubinstein, senior fellow here at the NYU, does not need introduction with over 20 years of experience in the privacy field. So we will start with the presentations that I guess could be for 10, 15 minutes. And after that, myself and Daniel Francis, who is a teaching fellow at Harvard University, are going to provide some comments that hopefully frame the discussion. And then we'll open for questions and answers to the audience. Sounds right. So without further ado, I give the floor to Nestor then.
Thank you so much. And thank you for having me, Bilyana and Ira. And I gather Kathy couldn't be here today, but I thank her also for organizing this. This is such a terrific topic for those of us who think about local government. I had once fantasized about writing about this, and then I saw that Ira was, and so I was glad someone was doing it and doing it very well. So I gather my brief to begin our conference today is to give the local government scholars' view of some kind of 10,000 foot level questions that we might want to foreground as we think about where privacy plays out in local governance. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about localism, and I'm going to make a pitch for why localism is not just a mini version of federalism, Heather Gerken's argument about federalism all the way down, notwithstanding. I actually think they're very, very different institutional concerns, normative concerns, and I think it's important to have a kind of basic vocabulary and framework that we can play with as we go through the day today. So if localism is the discourse of local government legal identity, then I think it's important to begin with something that's obvious, but easy to forget, especially if one, again, is thinking about federalism as a kind of baseline paradigm, which is the overriding reality for those of us who write about and those of us who teach local government law of institutional diversity. You have 50 states that are, you know, some interesting variations, a couple of unicameral legislatures and one or two little differences, but by and large, they're not exactly the same. Kathleen will kick me under the table, but there's much, much more uniformity and they're much closer to the federal structure. But things get really interesting when you turn the lens on the microscope and you start to look down at local government. So let me give you four dimensions on which I think local governance is actually quite different from states, and the state-local relationship is quite different from the federal-state relationship. So first, let's just begin with that vertical relationship. Notwithstanding some head feints towards reviving a sovereignty-based view of the states in the dialogue on federalism, I think it's safe to say that federal supremacy has really survived and is still the default baseline in federal-state relations. But in the structuring of state-local relations, it gets much more complicated. So we have this idea of home rule. Home rule is a state constitutional principle. It appears in roughly 40-42 of the states. You see different ways of counting it. But home rule was a movement that began in the late 19th century. Several waves of home rule reform during the Progressive Era, during the post-war suburban boom. And home rule really does give some genuine constitutional authority to local governments. Courts have had a hard time for more than a century actually living up to what home rule provisions in state constitutions say, but states are not plenary in the way that the Federal Supremacy Clause gives the federal government ultimate supremacy over the states. So you get a lot of variety. Things from two bordering states might be very, very different. Different kinds of local governments might have different power. You have charter cities in some states that have more power than non-charter cities. And so the basic question of what authority do local governments have to take action in the first place? Ira talks about this a little bit in his paper, and to resist preemption and the removal of authority from the states is a really interesting modeled mix, as David Barron and Jerry Frug have talked about, of some authority, some withdrawal of authority, and you really have to get very particular in any locality when you want to ask, what can this city or what can this county or what can this town do? And if the state disagrees, what power does this city or county or town or village have to resist the state? So then we have vertical. Sorry, that's vertical. We have horizontal elements of local governance that I think are very different. Just the fact that we have roughly 90,000 local governments around the country means that governance at the local level is much more fragmented, and particularly fragmented in the context of metropolitan governance. And that's been a reality really for most of the post-war era, and it's arguably gotten more significant. So there's a lot of overlapping jurisdiction, a lot of, again, fragmentation, and that really should, as we think about questions of, the kind of internal questions I was looking at in terms of how local governments manage their own data, manage their own privacy concerns, but also, as I'll talk about later, as local governments may actually be regulators, that kind of fragmentation and inter-local competition is very important. So the third dimension is what I think of as the kind of internal structural dimension of local governments. Again, the states, interesting places, not a lot of variety. Sometimes you have an elected AG, sometimes you get an agricultural commission that has a statewide elected official. But, you know, squint a little bit and you see a lot of what we get at the federal level. At the local level, you have local governments of general jurisdiction. You have lots of local governments, actually numerically more local governments that are of specialized jurisdiction. So school districts, municipal districts, various public authorities that actually do a lot of the work of local governance And they are not the city of New York or the city of San Francisco or Rensselaer County. They have taxing authority, some regulatory authority. They do, again, a lot of the work of governance, and they look very, very different in terms of their geographic scope, in terms of their authority. And I think as we collectively think about where localism plays out, it's actually really important not to default just to big cities. And there's a tendency, I think, to sort of say New York, and I'm a New Yorker, I love that, but it's actually really important to resist that instinct and really grapple with the tremendous variety. And there's also a tremendous variety of how even governments of local general jurisdiction, again, a county, a city, a town, can be structured. So New York has a strong, relatively strong mayor, a city council that looks a lot like what a legislature might look like at a state or, federal level. But often you have very weak mayors. In the majority of local governments of general jurisdiction, you have no separate executive. So if you want to think about questions of separation of powers, what do you do when all you have is a city council? And then you have an unelected council, city manager that actually performs the executive function. Again, as we think about the institutional questions of how do we check local power, how do we worry about which agencies keep which data, all of these really interesting granular questions, you have to keep in mind that you might be dealing with a very different structure of governance, no separation of powers whatsoever. And I think that can be significant in some context. And then the fourth dimension on which I think we have to grapple with all of this wonderful variety is there's much more ambiguity about role identity at the local level. So what do I mean by that? No one's going to look at a state and sort of ask, what is a state? Certainly we're not going to say the same thing of the federal government. But for 150 years, we've been having, localists have been having a vigorous debate about what the heck a local government actually is. So is it a public entity like we would think of any other level of governance, right? Is it a regulator? Is it just like any other public entity? And that would have implications for its regulatory authority, for its ability to shape the political destiny of a jurisdiction. Or is it just a delegated agent of the state, right? Is it like a State Department of Labor, except at a geographically limited level? That gives us a very different vision of what local government actually is. It's not. I have a great colleague, Aaron Sager, who's written a whole piece saying we shouldn't think of local governments as political entities. We should just think of them as administrative agencies, essentially. I don't agree with it, but it's a really interesting perspective, and it's a big one out there. Or are local governments just service providers? You can think of policing. You can think of traffic control. You can think of lots of things that local governments do. Education. That's just service provision. That's a very different vision. Or, and this doesn't exhaust the list, but this is one particularly important for thinking about privacy, is a local government just a market participant? Is it just a property owner? Is it a corporation? New York City is really the corporation of the city of New York. There's a long history of cities as having corporate identity. And many of the ways we think legally about local government still retain an element of that essentially private identity. And I think that's pretty important. So those are sort of four dimensions on which we can say that local governance is distinct from state and federal governance. And then we can kind of take a step back and talk about scale. So all of the arguments about back and forth about the values of devolution and decentralization that are at the heart of the debate about federalism, I think are even more pointed in the localist context. So on the pro side, all of these arguments for subsidiarity really do depend in many ways on a kind of small scale and intimacy that you won't get at the level of the state of Illinois or the state of California, but you do get even in the larger cities. So arguments for democratic engagement, right? This sort of Tocquevillian argument for decentralization. Arguments for preference targeting, the kind of specialized knowledge that comes from having those closest to the governed govern. The kind of Brandeisian experimentalist narrative. Again, much more ability to do that at the local level. And then mobility as both a motivator, entrance and the avoidance of exit, and as a disciplinary mechanism. People may not move from state to state all that often, although they do. They move around a metro area all the time. And that mobility narrative is much more important at the local level. Mm-hmm. And then the kind of general advantage of diffusing power. 50 states really bound up with the federal government. There's some advantage to that, obviously, as we see, whatever the political alignment is. But I think a lot more in the kind of Heather Gherkin dissenting by deciding and federalism all the way down argument. When you get 90,000 of them, there's a lot more locuses for power. So there are lots of counterarguments to all of these, disengaged politics, externalities, limits of capacity, a lot of great things that Ira talks about in his paper. But I think that it all kind of cashes out to bringing local governments, at least in the privacy sphere, to a much more central place than they've played. I think the advantages of localism outweigh in this context, and I don't think this of every context, but I think the advantages in terms of targeting, in terms of knowledge, in terms of experimentation, actually at the end of the day really do suggest a much more vigorous role for local governance in the privacy space than we've seen. So let me just conclude by kind of bringing this to some lessons I hope we talk through a bit during the day. As we think about where local governments fit in. So I think we need to really foreground institutional diversity. I think we really need to interrogate questions of scale. I think we need to kind of keep right in the front of our discussion kind of these ambiguities about public and private. There's a lot more intertwining at the local level. If you think about sidewalk labs doing Link NYC here in the city, that barrier between public and private at the local level breaks down a lot more often than it does at other levels of government. And finally, let me just say, I think, and I alluded to this before, I think it's really important, and this is kind of building a lot on what Ira is talking about, as important as it is to think about local governments as the objects of privacy law, right? How do we worry about data security? How do we worry about the trail we all leave in at the scale of local governance? How do we worry about how much easier it is for a city to de-anonymize than perhaps the federal local government? I think it's important for us also to think about local governments as the subjects of regulation, which is to say, we may be able to target preferences about levels of privacy at the local level in a way that I don't think we really have. But and this I'll throw it to Kathleen, but local governments are actually beginning to get into this business, and I actually think it's probably a good thing. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks so much for having me. I should say that I come at this, I do have a litigation background. Before I became an academic, I was a deputy city attorney for the city and county of San Francisco. And so I sort of think about this, I think about localism and federalism, but from the bottom up, as opposed to from the top down. So when I look at the current political context, you know, as we've seen, the FCC is on the retreat around privacy regulation, just like the federal government is on retreat in terms of regulating a lot of stuff. Congress seems to lack the political will to step in. We can expect states and localities to step in. And we can also, it'll be interesting to see if a universality of, like if universal norms around privacy and data end up developing, but right now, I'm kind of assuming for the sake of argument that they won't, right? And what happens if we don't kind of develop a national body of norms around data, you know, in the coming decades? I think that we're unlikely to see a cohesive state approach on this. You know, if you think about the map that you see during elections, you know, with the red states and the blue states, if there's such a thing as red data privacy, you know, ideas and blue data privacy ideas, right? We're not going to basically be able to replace what would have existed at the FCC level, at the state level. And I totally agree with what Nestor said in terms of like, don't default to New York when you think about cities, but also don't default to the idea that all cities are blue. In California, where I'm from, it's a blue state, quote unquote, right? But it's more complicated than that because there are red cities within California that might take a very different view of data privacy issues than the so-called blue cities. There are also cities that are more deeply blue in California than Sacramento. So like I live in Oakland, In the Bay Area, oftentimes we're sort of to the left of wherever Governor Brown is on a lot of stuff. So I think of it less in terms of blue or red and more in terms of just disagreement, just democratic disagreement across whatever the ideological spectrum is. So, you know, we'll see coming up red cities and counties in blue states, blue cities and counties in red states, and so on and so forth. So there's this really great phrase that from Ben Sachs's work in the labor context, where he talks about how the stalemate at the federal level in terms of addressing issues of management versus labor has caused, he calls it the hydraulic pressure of collective action in the labor context is being pushed down, right? Almost like, I almost think of it as water seeking the lowest point. And he said everything's frozen at the federal level, but that doesn't mean that people don't want solutions. And so there's pressure, there's political pressure that's coming down to the state level and to the local level. And when I look out at the kind of landscape that I see just based on kind of almost what you're reading in the papers on a daily basis, it just feels like all these issues are, like everything's being pushed down because the political pressure is moving downward because of the lack of progress at the federal level. And so I would expect to see this in terms of privacy as well. And you know, in particular, the problems of Citizens United and gerrymandering also occur within states. And for that reason, and Paul Diller's done really fantastic work on this, but for that reason, I would expect that the pressure to kind of pass the state level and go straight to the local level. Because the other dynamic that's going on is that cities are growing larger, even though they're not, never get as big as New York City is, they're growing larger because people are concentrating there. So they're becoming bluer to the extent that that democracy is being thwarted, or arguably thwarted, by things like gerrymandering, things like Citizens United, you can expect, I think, increasing pressure on cities to become expert in a lot of areas that they perhaps didn't become expert in. And so sometimes people say, well, cities are so parochial, what do they know? And it's like, well, they can learn. And they're learning, for, you know, in response to political pressure, right? Who do city constituents work for? They work for their, who do city elected officials work for? The constituents. That's who's in the back of their mind when they're operating and deciding what to do and what to wade into. Because why? Because they want to get elected again. So the same exact political pressures that animate electeds at the state and federal level are also operate at the local level. So if because of, you know, political disagreements, we can't quote unquote live together in the sense of reaching a national political consensus on something like privacy, then we have to figure out a way to live side by side, right? Perhaps this city has this way of approaching an issue, perhaps this county has another way of approaching the issue. As Nestor said very eloquently, the state constitutional home rule provisions do have the potential, at least in theory, to create space and oxygen for this side-by-side living together. The challenge, and I say this as a sort of a litigator in this area for a long time, has been to come up with stable principled tests for that courts can use to sort when the home rule provisions in state constitutions are trumped by the supremacy provisions and vice versa. So the challenge for those of us who are actually kind of focused at the granular level on coming up with tests that are workable for courts, that's kind of a frustration that that home rule has kind of run up against, and that I think we have the challenge of figuring out if we want to see this kind of living side by side work out over time. So there are obviously multiple dimensions of privacy localism. Just thinking there, the federal, state, and local regulatory dimensions, right? Regulating, which is to say regulating third parties. There are state constitutional dimensions. In the state constitutions, there are certain privacy norms that we've already agreed to. So, you know, you want to make sure and check state constitutions to figure out what those norms are, right? What's the backdrop of privacy norms, at least in California? The word privacy actually appears in the California Constitution. And so once, you know, at some point along the line, we agree to certain privacy norms, and everything that goes on in California is going to be read against that state constitutional backdrop. There's this tri-level democracy dimension, this how do we live together piece that I mentioned. There are really profound, obviously, I don't have to tell this group this, but just thinking about this from a from a localism standpoint, not really knowing about privacy, it sort of struck me in reading the wonderful papers that were in this conference, the really profound moral dimensions that go hand in hand with the tripartite democracy dimensions. And just to mention a few, you know, Susan Sontag once said that the act of taking a photograph is an act of aggression. And I feel like you could see data collection by both public and private actors as an act of aggression. As an inherent act of aggression, and so there's a moral dimension merely to the collection of that information. Then there's the moral dimension of the use of that data, right, which is a separate issue. And the policy choices by the federal, state, and local are gonna reflect the moral norms of their corresponding subset of their constituency. So if we think about constituencies as sort of Russian nesting dolls, you've got the local, you've got the state, you've got the federal. You might be in the majority at the local level, but in the minority at the state or the federal level, right? And you have a different moral sense of whether data should be collected and by whom and how it should be used and so on and so forth. And then the moral sense of the majority at the state or federal level. And this is quite profound and important question, one of the most important questions probably of our time. So how do cities and counties as entities interact with privacy norms? I think of this in terms of a dual role. As Nestor said, their cities and counties are public corporations, right? They incorporate, they collect and spend money. Instead of, you know, having shareholders, they have constituents that basically, you know, write them a check through the taxpayer. But they are public corporations, and as public corporations, they're collecting data all the time, usually because they're, at least ostensibly, because they're trying to do a good job of sort of like running this nonprofit organization, this nonprofit corporation. So when I'm teaching state and local government law, I think, well, think of it as a nonprofit, as a massive not-for-profit organization that is in the business of everything. And you start to get a sense of how it is that city government officials see their role. They're running this massive nonprofit. It's like the Walmart, right, of government, right? It's like Walmart's in the vegetable business now, in addition to being in the underwear business, right? Cities are in the hospital business, and they're in the road paving business, and they're in the policing business, and there's just a lot of, the corporation is engaging on a lot of levels, and it's quite complicated, and as it engages, it is inevitably perhaps collecting data, and it has to decide what to do with this data. Separate from that, cities are, think of themselves, to the extent, and I should cabin this and say, you know, when I was working for San Francisco, I thought, well, we are, you know, what are we? We are whatever our constituents want us to be. In San Francisco, our constituents want us to be engaged units of representative democracy in addition to public corporations. That's why we ended up filing the marriage equality case. You know, when you file the marriage equality case in San Francisco, and in response to that, the polls go to 85% approval, right, in San Francisco. That's when you know you're responding, you're basically doing that which your constituency expects you to do. If somebody tried to pull something like that in whenever it was, 2004, in a different kind of city, the polling would tell, in sort of a red city, Fresno, let's say, the polling would have told the mayor of Fresno to dismiss that case, right? We don't see you as a unit of representative democracy. We see you as somebody who's running a public corporation. So what cities are is actually a dynamic thing, and it's deeply connected to democracy and also the democratic norms of the constituency. And, you know, unsurprisingly, elected officials are highly sensitive to this. Why? Because they want to keep their jobs. So for the cities that act as units of representative democracy, the city actors are thinking of themselves as agents for constituents who may not only be threatened by the collection and use of government data, but also by the collection and use of private data by private corporations, right? So you don't want to lose sight of the fact that, you know, this conference is focused largely on the collection and use of data by governments, but there's also this other dimension, which is governments are looking out, and what they're seeing is the collection and use of data by private entities that may be harming the constituents, and they may get political pressure to do something about that. So for example, San Francisco, which is a city and a county, sued Equifax a week ago today, alleging unfair business practices that harmed, I think, 17 million San Franciscans, or 17 million Californians were impacted by the Equifax breach. And so the city and county of San Francisco sued on behalf of the people of the state of California, with the blessing, essentially, of the people of San Francisco, to protect its constituents from the collection and use of data by Equifax and the failure to protect citizens from that breach. Now, San Francisco tends to be kind of the tip of the spear, right? San Francisco and New York, in terms of thinking of itself as a unit of representative democracy, really assertively thinking of itself that way. But it wouldn't surprise me if other cities started to follow suit. Whenever I hear, oh, well, you know, San Francisco, I'm like, well, yeah, San Francisco this week, and next week, Austin. And the week after that, Atlanta. I mean, in other words, you know, to the extent that the political pressure is getting pushed down, I don't see any reason why other cities aren't going to be getting the kind of, aren't going to be getting pressured to become more robust, let's say, actors within this unit of representative democracy. So obviously cities, you know, cities are data collectors, counties are data collectors, cities have police, that's a high concern issue. Counties have sheriffs and jails and public hospitals. Keep an eye on the fact that cities and counties are not the same thing, and that cities and counties have different delegated actions, right? So San Francisco, at least in California, is the only city and county, so it has police and jails. But in other parts of California, the cities run the police, the counties run the jails, right? Different data collection concerns there. The county may run the public hospital. That's going to be a huge data collection issue, right? So they're just sort of, what you'll notice is that it starts to break down along city and county lines, and you just want to keep an eye on that. Cities and counties are at least in theory potential regulators of private data collectors doing business within their jurisdiction. Potential regulators of private data collectors. But keep your eye on the fact that cities and counties also exercise power in non-regulatory ways, right? They try to exercise power and influence in non-regulatory ways, non-regulatory. So for example, they might tuck their regulatory preferences into city contracts, right? Voluntary city contracts with private entities, hoping to push private entities in a particular direction in a way that causes a domino effect. This happened with marriage equality back 20 years ago before anybody was thinking about that. San Francisco got most businesses within San Francisco through just public contracting to that place, right? So the power of the purse operates there. Watch for cities to tuck policy preferences into city permitting, business permitting, and then frame it as land use regulation, right? Because land use is kind of triggers in everybody's mind, oh, well, this is the one place where cities can regulate all they like. And so, you know, if you want to open a business in a city, the city might try to say, well, yeah, we'll give you a business permit. You want a bricks and mortar space? Fine. Here are our permitting requirements, and they might include things that have to do with data privacy, just like they included, just like they might include things that have to do with other public policy priorities. And then also, you know, look for more city litigation against, and this gets very complicated, but private actors, as I said, like Equifax, but also public actors, like the federal government, like the state government. Cities are starting to get increasingly comfortable with holding especially the state government's feet to the fire. If the state government is doing something that the city believes is contrary to state statute or to the state constitution, especially if there's a privacy norm in the state constitution. This is where the first marriage cases came up, where cities were plaintiffs in those cases. They sued their own states under state actors alleging lack of conformance to state constitutional law. So I would really watch for that in the privacy space as well, to the extent that you end up with a blue-red, red-blue divide. So Nestor touched on this, you know, the questions when cities and counties act, or do they have the institutional authority in the first instance to take this particular action? This is a powers question. Get used to thinking of that as totally separate from a preemption question. Sources of possible authority: state constitutional provision, state statutory provision, local charter, if any, local ordinance. Is this particular act, if it's an executive branch or a legislative act, is this particular act preempted by state law? And if so, is it appropriately preempted? Right? The state legislature can claim, oh, we're going to preempt city action in the area of privacy. But you could actually say, you could actually say, well, you're going to claim preemption, but that's not appropriate preemption because of home rule provisions. But going back to my earlier point about the sorting mechanisms, local government scholars basically are working around the clock to figure out sorting mechanisms that will allow breathing space for localities. If it's litigation by a city attorney or county council's office, does the city have standing to sue? This is a really live controversy because to the extent that courts see cities as public corporations, it makes no sense to courts that they would come into and sue Equifax over what happened to consumers, right? But if a court sees cities as having this dual role of public corporation and unit of representative democracy, they would say, well, sure, why should it have to be a plaintiff's lawyer? Why should it have to be the ACLU? Why can't it be the elected representative of the constituency? So I will end by just saying, here's some things to watch out for. Watch out for people interested in privacy to dust off and crack open the structural and substantive provisions of state constitutions. The thing that connects federalism to localism is state constitutionalism. And that is something that we have to open up that middle space and really look at it to understand the democracy fully from top to bottom. Watch for privacy scholars, like First Amendment scholars, to write papers about whether privacy norms that exist in state constitutions should be rethought in light of the technological revolution and revised. So look for privacy to become, data privacy and privacy in general, to become like one of these topics that that comes up around amending state constitutions or opening them up or taking another look at them. Watch for battles within organizations like ALEC and the State Innovation Exchange over, you know, if you want to know if there's like a red and blue approach to data privacy issues, you can do a lot worse than just to check the ALEC and State Innovation Exchange websites, because they sort of represent a quick kind of a snapshot of how the politicos are thinking about these issues. Watch for cities and counties to independently build out their administrative capacity and expertise in areas of not only public but private data collection and use, in the same way they've built out, for example, the anti-terrorism capability as they grow larger and get more and robust more engagedly. Watch for states and localities, to the extent that they disagree, to push against state legislators and state executive officials. Watch for them to test the limits of preemption, the use of non-regulatory forms of local government dissent. And watch for courts to grapple anew with questions of state preemption of local law, sensitive potentially to the political powder keg that could really erupt if urban policy preferences keep getting squelched by things like gerrymandering and by things like Citizens United, right? Because as we become a more urban country, and I think that courts tend to be sensitive to these political matters, and therefore I think that courts are going to, over time, probably be open to and looking for ways to create breathing space in areas of data privacy along with other important kind of modern topics. And that's what I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, so I'm going to speak about a pretty lengthy paper that I wrote and try to summarize the findings. In a way, Nestor and Kathleen's remarks set this up very nicely, because to a localism scholar, these sorts of headlines and this sort of activity on the part of cities may not seem all that peculiar or surprising, but as someone who's been doing privacy for about 20 years and who's taught it for about 10 years, if you open a privacy casebook, there's not a word about cities. So this really took my breath away, in a sense, to think surveillance. That's like Snowden and the NSA. What are cities doing in this space? And I very quickly came to see that what they're doing resembles the controversies that are arising now over a host of other issues that were typically treated at the national level, but for some of the reasons you've both discussed, are now being pushed down to the local level, immigration, marriage equality, campaign financing, gun control, a whole host of issues. So I decided in pursuing my analysis of these developments to try to use that localism framework, which was totally new to me. So I apologize for any failings in my framing of the issue, but I found this the right way to frame it and benefited greatly from some of both of your work. So I call this privacy localism. You'll see the slightly different italicized words in the first two lines. And as I say in the paper, by privacy localism, I refer to local control over the collection, use, and disclosure of personal data of city residents. So all of the ordinances, laws, guidelines, directives, anything issued by a local government bearing on traditional privacy issues. And by privacy localism, emphasis on the second word, I have in mind the benefits of local autonomy and decentralization. So some of the values that Nestor identified. And the way I structure the paper then is to first try to sort out some differences in emphasis between localism and federalism, then look at the two key issues that Nestor already identified and that Kathleen spoke of as well, the question of city empowerment on the one hand, do they have the authority to act in this space? And maybe this is because I studied New York and Seattle as my case studies, the answer was clearly yes. It could have been different with different cities because mm-hmm. this varies quite a bit. Washington and New York are both home rule states, and both those cities are charter cities, so they have sufficient powers. And then I focus much more heavily on the question of immunity from override by the federal or state legislatures, which is the issue of preemption. Then the paper proceeds to the two case studies, and then I try to make a case for why I think this activity on the part of cities is valuable and of lasting significance. So I'll go through this rather quickly. I guess I have just two main points to make, or maybe three main points to make. One is that when we think of federalism in terms of old-fashioned dual sovereignty, that the federal government and the state government each have their spheres in which they should act, this is a view of federalism that's no longer very prominent or popular. That doesn't really resonate with privacy law particularly, other than kind of the historical accident of the privacy torts being state law. Federal and state governments get along pretty well in privacy. You don't see any of the states' rights controversies that have arisen over the years occurring in the privacy world. The other popular understanding or doctrine around federalism is so-called cooperative federalism, which is the notion that the federal government establishes various regulatory programs with funding, with standards, which are then implemented at the state level. Obamacare is a superb example of that, as are various welfare programs, environmental programs, a lot of which have generated all sorts of controversies. Again, these controversies simply don't arise in the privacy world. And part of the reason for that, I argue, and here, there may be nuances and subtleties that I'm leaving out and need to refine my thinking a bit, but I'm making some very broad claims having looked at like all privacy laws, but I know some laws better than others. I would still contend that this notion of a federal regulatory program where the federal government says, here's a bunch of money, here are the standards, now go out and accomplish this mission. If the mission is privacy, there are no such programs. That's my contention. Now, there may be homeland security programs with privacy implications that raise privacy issues that are structured in this way, but I can't think of a single federal privacy program where the federal government says, this is how we want you to implement privacy on a nationwide basis. Here's a bunch of money that all 50 states get, and now go do it according to these standards. So if anyone has contrary examples, I'd be interested to hear them. My point is not to make that claim as to say that traditional understandings of federalisms just don't provide that many insights into this topic. However, it's necessary to think in terms of preemption because that's somewhat an inevitable issue. And there are about 25 federal privacy laws. I argue that most of them either are exclusively about federal agencies or federal activities, or they're narrowly regulating certain commercial sectors, or they lack preemption clauses, or at worst, if they bear on the topics that I'm interested in and they have any kind of preemptive force, in all likelihood, they're just setting floors. They're setting minimal standards, and they permit states to go higher. So in that sense, even to the extent that they're relevant, which is limited, they don't really get in the way very much. So I think it's really at the state-city level, over these questions of power and immunity, that you get into more interesting issues. Again, I won't belabor this, but I think the power question is not all that problematic, at least for the two cities that I focus on. The preemption issue, though, is much bigger. And here, since there are, and I'm sure our local government experts are very familiar with this, but this was kind of new to me. When you try to study the states, you run into this little problem that there are 50 states, and there are lots of laws. And if you want to really say something important rather than just by the seat of your pants, you have to do a lot of research. So fortunately, since my case studies were just two cities, that limited my focus to two states, and I narrowed down which laws I was going to look at based on the types of surveillance activities going on in both Seattle and New York that were subject to those surveillance ordinances that I highlighted in the first slide. And what I found was that I was in the arena of state regulation of surveillance devices that had a focus on public spaces. So not all surveillance devices, but in particular, video cameras, automatic license plate readers, gun detection systems, drones insofar as they carry some of this equipment, and so on. Things that focused on the public space, which interestingly is also an arena where both federal constitutional and federal statutory law is largely absent. So that provided some of the motivation, I think, for cities to step into this space. And I divided that preemption analysis into two parts, one looking at laws on public surveillance technology and the other looking at laws on actual data governance at the city level. So at the federal level, of course, you have the Privacy Act, which regulates federal agencies only. About a dozen states have similar laws. Those laws only regulate state government agencies. So the way was open for cities to regulate their own data governance. So summing up a rather lengthy analysis of these laws, the thing to pay attention to here is the ends. Ends are good for me. If those were all wise, then I would have to conclude that this is a heavily regulated field where cities are largely preempted from activity. So N is good here. There are some pending laws in New York anyway on automatic license plate readers and drones. There are other states that I pay attention to as well. I don't want this analysis to just be a happenstance of picking states where these laws aren't present. But even in those other states that are beginning to regulate in these areas, I think the key point is that they're, number one, single technology laws, whereas, as we'll see in a moment, the city surveillance ordinances are comprehensive. They're not limited to any one technology. And number two, these are laws that basically set minimum requirements as to things like data retention or data use or sharing with third parties or what kind of warrant requirements apply. So again, I don't see that as really hamstringing city government seeking to regulate in this area so much as setting some basic conditions. If New York City or Seattle were in states that regulated drones, for example, and there was a state law requirement that you had to get a warrant to use a drone for public surveillance, fine, then the cities would just follow that rule, but it wouldn't result in some legal clash that forced the city to withdraw the ordinance as you know, conflicting with the state law that then preempted the city approach. Okay, so that said, let's move now to the case studies, which are fairly detailed, but again, I'm going to try to capture them in very quick overview. And I split the analysis between the two cities, focusing first of all on these surveillance ordinances, and then secondly on privacy principles affecting city collection of data. So how many of you are just familiar at all with these surveillance ordinances? Because maybe I should back up and say a little bit more about what they are. So a lot of you are, but basically these are about a dozen or more cities, maybe as many as 20, adopting laws that are at least somewhat based on a model law put forward by ACLU and others. Seeking for communities to begin regulating the surveillance technologies that local law enforcement was adopting, using fundamentally a transparency and accountability method. So the requirements under these laws are that before acquiring and using these technologies, cities would have to prepare surveillance impact reports, what's the effect on civil liberties, as well as certain operational and use protocols describing what rules they would follow. And in some cities, and counties as well, you then have to submit that to the city council for approval. And the city council votes up or down. New York is a little bit different, as I'll say in a moment. So these are really interesting in a couple of respects, one of which is that unlike almost every federal and state law addressing surveillance technology, this ordinance is not technology specific. It applies to any surveillance technology, with some modest exceptions that mostly have to do with the fact that the accepted technologies are being addressed in some other fashion. So some of these policies exempt body cameras, and that's because cities have often some other process already in place for developing policies around body cameras. So it's a very comprehensive approach. It's very much focused on accountability and transparency. In the Seattle case, there was it was really the first city to adopt an ordinance. This was, I think, 2009. The ordinance turned out to be fairly weak. The police just largely ignored it. There were no filings were made. Nothing much happened. And then, as is often the case in the U.S., there was a media brouhaha about the police using some social media analysis tool, and the press got a hold of this, and there was a big controversy, and everybody decided to sit down and revise the ordinance. The revised ordinance is really quite a nice piece of work. It's very comprehensive. One innovation, at least from the point of view of the ACLU more than the police, is that it not only regulates technology, it also regulates data. So it regulates surveillance data. Now, this is only data associated with surveillance technology owned or operated by the city. So it would exclude data that might be provided by a state agency or a federal agency, say through a fusion center or otherwise. And the police in Seattle were quite concerned about that provisions for reasons I'll talk to in a moment. So it expanded to technology and data. It still required that these reports be produced. It also had a very explicit provision on community outreach, that as part of the initial process for the city to prepare these protocols that it had to submit, it would also have meetings with the community. So a very heavy emphasis on community participation, a key value of localism. It has an approval mechanism. The police in Seattle supported the ordinance, but they did raise this concern about, number one, the burdensomeness of the city council being the bottleneck that had to approve all of these applications. And I agree that that's a very serious problem. I think there's really a need for some other body to do some initial screening and supplement the work that the city council would otherwise have to do. At the hearings on the ordinance, there were estimates that there could be like 150 big technologies. There could be like another 1,500 that might qualify as technology under the statute, but they were reviewing 10,000 technologies and data combinations. So the notion that a city council would put this on its agenda and do like dozens and dozens of these approvals, I think just doesn't make a lot of sense. The police also raised a concern about whether this would result in Seattle becoming what they called a data island, in the sense that by participating in data exchange programs at the regional and state level, if there were, that there's a requirement in the Seattle ordinance that any transfers occur subject to the requirements of the Seattle ordinance, and that you then have to say how you're going to enforce those restrictions you've put in place when you're transferring data to another city. Now, the other city may say, well, that's fine, Seattle, but we don't have such a law and we don't want these restrictions. What happens then? That was the police argument. In New York, on the other hand, New York began even earlier than Seattle, not with an ordinance, just with a voluntary set of guidelines that are rolled out at the same time as the domain awareness system, which is the big kind of surveillance tool that was developed, co-developed by New York City and Microsoft shortly after 9/11. It kind of combines all of the surveillance cameras downtown with ALPRs and gunshot detectors and so on and so forth. It had a limited technology. It required reports that would be prepared, and then it would open for public comments, but there was no explicit outreach requirement. And it also didn't have a council approval provision. So it's just a transparency requirement. And I think this is interesting. I'll try to speed up after this, but this is really the heart of it. I think it's interesting to think about this. In Seattle, you have council approval, but a lot of burden. In New York City, you have rather, and this maybe is a bit too cynical, the council in effect saying, police, if you want it, you own it. So to the extent that there's any political fallout, the police prepare a report, it goes public, there's an outcry, now it's up to the police to go forward or not go forward. So they're left holding the bag. And the reason for that may be that the city council did want to be the one disapproving some technology, which the police then said subsequently, we could have prevented this attack, such as not that the attack, I mean, the attack the other day was a lone wolf attack. I think there's no way to prevent that. But the city council didn't want to be in the position of being accused of getting in the way of the police. So this may just be a political compromise more than anything else. But the police in New York City bitterly oppose this for reasons that a lot of people think are dubious. They're claiming that any level of transparency is going to give a hands up to the terrorists and the criminals if they know how this technology works. So a lot of people dismiss this argument as a bit hysterical. I'll move more quickly now on the city privacy principles. So these are principles regarding the city's own collection and use of data. Seattle has a very well-developed, well-publicized program. In New York City, and if there are anybody here from the New York City government, I'd be delighted to speak with them. I had more difficulty kind of parsing what was going on and getting the information that I needed, so I'm a little less sure about how things are. But the principles are similar. It's mostly just a question of scope and resources to the programs. So let me close quickly by making what I'm calling the case for privacy localism. I think some of the benefits are that these approaches really deliver on the promise of transparency and accountability. They do reflect values of local autonomy. As you saw, there's something very innovative about this comprehensive framework. I mean, it may not sound that innovative, but this is U.S. privacy law, which has been sectoral for almost 50 years. So it's a different step. If you're European, you might think, well, where's the innovation? Of course, it should be comprehensive, but it is a big deal nonetheless. There are ways of encouraging community participation. There's local diversity reflected, even in the fact that the New York City and Seattle rules are not the same, and they reflect a different local reality. Seattle's never suffered a serious terrorist attack. That said, there are some concerns. One obviously is, and we have some city officials here who may be happy that I'm pointing this out, you know, there's a question of expertise and resources in the sense, not that cities don't know how to do this, but they're jumping into a big, big arena, and they're not, you know, they're not the federal government. They don't have the institutional infrastructure in place that we assume when the federal government rolls out an environmental program or rolls out Obamacare. There's like, you know, hundreds of millions and billions of dollars floating around. There are thousands of bureaucrats. I don't know what Ginger's office is, but what's your staff? Like two, three, four? Okay, four. So, you know, there's a lot of work to do for a very small staff. So that's an issue. And it maybe requires thinking about some other models that could be used, which I'll say more about if it comes up in the Q&A. There's also this risk of fragmentation and data islands. One really interesting response to that, although it may not result in a law that's enacted, is the California response. So about half a dozen California cities have begun to adopt these local ordinances. And then the California legislature introduced a bill, the first draft of which was apparently just garbage. It was just badly drafted. But then for whatever good reason, whatever good luck there was, the sponsor of that bill listened to comments received from the public advocacy community, redrafted the bill. And I'd be interested in Nestor and Kathleen's thoughts on this too. The bill, rather than saying we're the state, we're taking over, it said cities in California must adopt similar ordinances. So it left it at the city level. It didn't step on the city's toes at all. It basically said, if you're a city, you have to have a process in place, and it modeled the required process on the existing ordinances in the California cities, which is sort of a very, you know, cooperative, friendly way to go about it, rather than just saying, we're the state, we're more powerful, you're gonna do it our way now. I'm not sure that bill's gonna pass, but it's a very interesting model. And that would be a way to perhaps address the data island issue. And then I won't elaborate on this, but I think the city approach is a little too focused on regulation as opposed to using technological means for protecting privacy. And I can give examples of that if people are interested. So finally, I relate this to two other trends that the privacy scholars in the room will be very familiar with, so I'll be very quick about it. One is what I'm calling the public surveillance gap, and this is just the long-standing doctrinal weakness of the Fourth Amendment in addressing what many people call privacy in public. Basic idea is that if you're law enforcement, you know, what you see with your eyes is available to you. You can't be blocked from taking advantage of what you can see. So if people are outside of their home, outside of a private setting, in the public space, then basically anything law enforcement can view is outside of a search and hence not protected by the Fourth Amendment. And I don't, again, this is a discussion we can have a little later on, but I don't think Jones changes this all that much, because Jones, which is a long-term GPS monitoring case, really focuses on tracking individuals, whereas the kinds of technologies that I'm talking about are, they're wide, but they're not very deep. They can be converted into something that tracks individuals, but that's not their primary focus. So I don't know that the court is gonna change its view. The statutory gap is that the federal electronic surveillance law, ECPA, excludes video surveillance, basically end of story. And so do almost all state statutes, which tend to be modeled on ECPA. So I think that these local surveillance ordinances are an important step in closing this gap, and that makes them interesting for yet another reason. And then finally, there's been a lot of work on introducing a more administrative law approach to the policing crisis. We have a scenario where police departments operate under like 15 word provisions that basically say the police shall protect the public safety. And then, unlike almost any other agency that operates at the federal, state, or local level and is subject to either the Administrative Procedures Act or state variant or city variant of that, or just similar norms where rules are developed in a transparent way, the public has input, and they're adopted through a democratic process, it's like what Barry Friedman calls police exceptionalism. That just doesn't seem to apply to police departments. So there's a scholarly movement to begin to introduce this administrative framework into police governance. And again, I just argue that these local privacy regulations like precisely fit that model. So in addition to, I think, just doing good work from a privacy standpoint, these local regulations also intersect very nicely with these very live issues in privacy law around both public surveillance and police governance. And I'll stop there.
Thank you very much to Ira and also to our other presenters. So all three presentations were fascinating, very rich material for discussion. I'm going to give some brief comments and I have 3 points for the three speakers that hopefully are tying up the presentations and open up for debate. Then I'll give the floor to Daniel to also have his comments. And we might run over and take some of the time for the coffee break. So be warned that there is an interesting discussion here. I think that is going on also. It's going to go between our panelists. All right, so having thought about federalism from a comparative perspective a little bit, I was of the opinion that when we were discussing the concept of the conference with Kathy and Ira, that privacy, localism, and localism as such, for that matter, are distinct from federalism. So in other words, to cite with Nestor's sharp observation, the institutional identity of localities is much more complex than that of the states vis-a-vis the federal tier. So having said that, I want to push back a little bit and ask whether we really need a new vocabulary to try and make sense about what is happening on the ground. So obviously federalism and localism are neither mentioned in the US Constitution, but federalism has already shaped some judicial doctrine that has been criticized by the academia. One way or the other, we have their established vocabulary. So to the extent that cooperative and uncooperative federalisms become cooperative and uncooperative localisms, and both I think Nestor and Kathleen have written on these, can we talk about a shared vocabulary? So that's, and as an offshoot of my first point, if we zoom on the concept now of privacy localism, and here I'm coming to Iris' presentation, is there something distinct in privacy that makes it unique from other localisms? So when Ira discusses the local pushback against the Patriot Act at the beginning of his paper, for those of you who have had the chance to look at the paper, he says that distinction between expressive and regulatory pushback, placing privacy localism in the former category rather than the latter, since for him local officials lack enforcement power, something that Heather Gerken calls the power of the servant. So if local officials lack this kind of enforcement powers, it's mainly the private sector on which we depend here in that case, there is therefore more space for expressive rather than regulatory localism. So that goes to Nestor's nice categorization on the ambiguity of cities and localities as somewhere on a spectrum between a public corporation and a market participant. But is privacy localism always of the declaratory type, or can we see in other cases perhaps also of the other regulatory type, if you will? So if you think about maybe grants that are for establishing video cameras or facial recognition technology, could be there also space for regulatory, let's say, localism, if you want to call it that way. So in terms of the level of regulation, and that's my third point here, it's grounded on the idea of subsidiarity that also Nestor mentioned, which is actually a legally binding principle of European law. But if we think about the idea, this is understood as achieving a certain objective effectively as closer to the ones affected as possible. So that's the idea of subsidiarity, to try to achieve an objective as closer to the citizen as possible, but also in an effective manner. So on the one hand, the case for privacy localism as a gap-filling tool that corresponds to the lower tier of regulation seems intuitive. Policing and urban policies are both matters for local communities, right? So as much as they correspond to local values and are therefore to remain local. Think about obscenity laws that are in the same way norms of civility that are also widely different. So this is also, if we think about Robert Post's idea of local communities defining local values, then privacy would remain rather a local issue. But there's also the question of efficiency and effectiveness. And so if we move to that question, it seems to me that there's also the part of the debate where we think about privacy standards not on the local level, not on the national level, not on the European or not the American level, but rather on the international even level. So think about establishing standards also, whether within the framework of the United Nations or the WTO. This could be achieved also through norm diffusion to a certain extent. So this ties back to Kathleen's hypothetical that we heard about, also the norm diffusion in cities within the United States. Do cities actually speak to each other? So when Seattle was enacting these ordinances, did New York officials had a look at these? So we see that in the National Conference of State Legislatures, there's something like draft legislation being, draft bills being suggested. Is there something like this with the National League of Cities that is happening? I want to stretch that argument even further, but that's probably a bit too ambitious at that stage, and say that cities can also communicate across borders. So cities in Europe, Latin America, whatever, global cities that can adopt similar policies. And then a final very little point about the methodology of case study selection. So both Seattle and New York are blue cities in largely blue states. Is what happens with preemption if we pick blue cities in largely red states what one would expect to happen, or do we see their role for the courts? And that Kathleen started already, I think, answering that question. So I was wondering whether Ira had had a look in these, or perhaps it could be something valuable to look into. Thank you, and then I'll pass the floor to Danny.
Hello. Oh, good Lord, it works. So maybe uniquely on this panel, I know nothing about either privacy or local government, so I'm here as a federalism person, really to learn about an area of government that I don't think about very often. Ira, as you know, I love the paper, I love the project, and I love decentralized government, so I agree with the great majority of what we've heard so far. But in an effort to sort of play for the other team, I want to offer a couple of skeptical or cautionary notes about what Ira calls privacy localism. So in that light, I really just have three questions, I think, about whether we really should be as optimistic as Ira and others would have us be. So the first, I think, Ira, there is, and perhaps to Nestor and Kathleen as well, it seems to me there is a strong and a weak way to read the claim, certainly at the heart of Ira's paper. So the weak way is that if federal and state governments aren't acting, and if we think there is a valuable project out there in the world of protecting privacy, then cities should step in and do something about it. That, I think, is the most modest version of the claim. I think it's uncontroversial, but very appealing. A stronger version of that claim might be that local governments, municipal governments in particular, are not just available to step up, but are in some sense preferable. They're in some sense better situated than federal or state governments, and we should order our political life, order our political activity to reflect their special ability to act in this space. I think that's the stronger and more interesting version of Ira's claim, at least as I read it, and that's the one that I'm going to respond to here. So about that, I'm going to say three things. The first is, in order for local governments, including not just municipal but also county governments, to act, federal and state governments, federal and state law, can't resolve the question. So that means we need to create and preserve what Ira and others refer to as a regulatory gap at the federal and state level in order to allow the kind of experimentation and innovation that we're hearing about. My first question is whether that's really such a great idea. So what we've heard about is what New York City and Seattle, two of the largest, best resourced, most expertise, I don't even know if there's a way to finish that word, enjoying the greatest resources and expertise and capacity to fill this function, have accomplished. My reading, despite all the optimism that we've heard, is that in fact it's been pretty modest. And it's been pretty modest even given the fact that the political will to pursue that project is as great in Seattle and New York City as it's going to be in any city anywhere in the United States. So question one, Ira, if it's true that we want to not just appreciate but encourage privacy localism, isn't it true that we would need to create a regulatory gap? We need to be comfortable with a federal and state low floor that provided this big space for experimentation, recognizing that if this is what we see for Seattle and New York City, imagine what it would be in Minneapolis or in Lansing or in county governments. And would that adequately reflect the interests we're trying to protect? Second question, slightly different. Second question is, are we really looking here in the right place? So Ira has focused, I think, very persuasively on areas where there's been real innovation. Development of norms, principles, guidelines, codes, legal and quasi-legal rules of general application. I wonder whether that's the sphere in which we really see the kind of problem that we're concerned about when we worry about privacy protection in this context. And in particular, as someone who knows nothing about policing or privacy or even much about local government at all, I wonder whether the real problem might be much more granular. And it might be in individual practices, individual policing decisions that are made not at the general level, not even at the level of norms of broad application, but in individual act and investigation specific decisions to use technology in particular ways that cannot be effectively monitored at the level of here is our general principle, here is our broad norm of how privacy should be protected in New York policing. In other words, is the kind of normative work that we see in New York and Seattle really going to go to the heart of where the problem is in intransparent and undemocratic policing structures and practices? So the third and last of my comments before I wrap up is a question that is in some sense even more basic. And that question is whether we really want to push this kind of thing to cities at all. And I want to give three reasons why we might not want to do so. The first is that if, in our project of developing a set of norms and rules that appropriately protects privacy in an age where both private and public technology and practices are more invasive of privacy than ever before, is local law really the tool with which we want to fashion those protections? It is singularly vulnerable. Even if enacted in the form of binding law, which most of these measures are not, but it is singularly vulnerable to federal and state intervention, both in terms of the enaction of federal and state law that fails to respect those practices, which will cut right through local government protection, and, less transparently, in the practices of the very federal and state officials who provide local government and local polices with a great deal of their funding. So reason number one why we might not want to push this to cities and to local governments is because local law, even when we use law, is a very weak armor against the kind of things we're trying to protect against. Reason number two is that there's a spirit sometimes that animates discussions of localism that suggests that making something more local makes it more democratic and promotes kind of harmonious communitarian policies that reflect homogeneous preferences. I think we have a great deal of reason, both in theory and experience, to think that that is just not true in a great many cases. We are most comfortable pushing things to the local level when we are least worried about those decisions being used to oppress local minorities by local majorities. And I want to suggest, without having much time to develop the point, that when it comes to things like balancing policing practices in light of the competing interests of preventing and, you know, preventing and responding to crime on the one hand, and appropriately respecting the dignity and privacy and other interests of individuals, particularly, but not exclusively, individuals in minority or oppressed communities in a locality, then we might have considerable store of reasons to be skeptical about the idea that local government is the right place to locate those decisions. The third is not exclusively, but particularly clear in the counterterrorism context to which Ira returned a few times. And this comes straight out of federalism theory, and the suggestion is this. It's true, I think, that the subjects of counterterrorism surveillance can be found almost everywhere. Right, so even if we think about the 9/11 hijackers, right? Khalid Sheikh Mohammed went to school in North Carolina. Three of the four pilots lived in San Diego. They trained in rural South Florida. But while the subjects of surveillance are nationally distributed, the targets, the risks of terrorist activity are highly concentrated. And if it's true, as I think it is, that the costs of policing and surveillance are localized, are internalized by the communities, where intrusive policing takes place, where the costs of surveillance are borne, but the benefits in the form of the prevention of terrorism are externalized to other parts of the country, New York, Washington, elsewhere, then isn't it true that as a matter of straightforward federalism theory, we would expect localities to radically undersupply surveillance and radically overprotect privacy in certain contexts when we're dealing with counterterrorism policy? So with those comments in mind, I think Ira's project is fantastic. I think the three sharp questions that I would ask to sort of frame my interest, at least, in how it develops from here are the following. Number one, is there evidence that federal and state governments are following local lead? Are they really acting as laboratories of democracy here? Number two, what can Ira or Nestor or Kathleen tell us about the kinds of privacy that should be locally protected and the kinds of privacy protections that should not be located at the local level? And the third, do we see a change, do we see a path from the kind of informal guidelines that we've heard about to concrete effects, concrete practices? I certainly haven't seen yet evidence that these guidelines have translated into effects on policing practices. But that, for me, seems like it might be where the truly interesting thrust of this project might lie. And I would love to hear about how it translates into practice. Thank you.
Right, maybe now we open for discussion.
Yes, indeed.
And if you don't mind to take
I'm
the
happy to keep Q&A. It here. So before we do you want to give the panelists an opportunity to respond briefly to anything that's been said, starting with Nestor?
Sure. Do we have 45 minutes, 2 hours?
Right.
Terrific comments all, and I don't know that I can absorb and respond to all of them. Let me just pick two or three. First, I think, tying together a number of critiques, I think partly it depends how we think about the right allocation of authority here. Partly depends on what kind of faith we have that a somewhat muddling through of some combination of experimentation and local democracy and a responsive process can actually work, right? I do think that you have to come back to what Iris was talking about in terms of a floor, and I don't accept the premise that it's an inherently weak floor, because we can have that conversation the same way, right? We can say, what are the national norms that we want to baseline? And then where do we, in encountering particular problems at the local level where you have concentrated concerns, right, and different preferences, I do think that is true, where can we vary from that floor? But if we really truly want national standards, and I think they should be national, then that doesn't mean that we have to somehow back off if we're also going to preserve some space for a more responsive locality, right? So that's that maybe leads to a more cooperative federalist regime, but it doesn't mean that the states or the federal government have to back off at all. It just means that there have to be mechanisms for perhaps gaining additional protection at the local level if that's appropriate. The other thing I would say is, and this ties together a couple of comments, I think it is inevitable that if local governments are collecting data in the way that they are and doing surveillance in the way that they are, and they all are. And again, this is true of the largest global cities. It's also true of small rural utility districts, right? Mm-hmm. That have a lot of data about your energy consumption, right? Then I think you cannot avoid grappling with this at the local level. We may not get it right. There are lots of wonderful, interesting mechanisms of policy diffusion, and I'm happy to talk more about that. But the thought that we can actually have these governments and entities at the local level of all of the varieties I've talked about not engage and not try to get it right, I think is just not a choice. So it's much more a question of what are the right principles and not whether or not local governments should be involved in this, because they are, they will be, they have to be.
That's great. And Kathleen, also for a quick couple minutes response, and while you're talking, I will take a cue from questions from the floor.
Yeah, I think I actually think that from my perspective, it's very hard to know. Sometimes I feel like when I listen to scholars, the policy and the law squishes together. So I never really, as a scholar, I consider myself a scholar of democracy. So I share your view that actually, I don't think federalism and localism are two different subjects. I think it's one subject. I think it's one machine.
Right.
And there are parts of the machine that we understand less well than others, but it's one machine. And so I actually do think that a common vocabulary, at least in my work, is where I'm headed. And because I'm a scholar of democracy, I'm actually more interested in what's going to be demanded at different levels. Inevitably, like Nestor said, what's going to be demanded of localities than by the constituencies that aren't currently being demanded as a result of pressure, then I am in answering the question of, like, which level should we prefer? I feel like that's actually a democratic question. And then within the democratic question, you have, like, the policy debate over, like, should we really be doing this, right? I see that as, like, playing out within the democratic landscape. And then the other thing is that I really want to, I hate the idea of laboratories of democracy. I think it's complete codswallop to think of cities as laboratories for anything. I think there's sites of democracy. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, I think that states are less sites of democracy than, like, mechanisms for funneling democratic norms, right? But cities are, like, literal sites for democracy. I never think about cities as, like, oh, if we do this really well, maybe the federal government will follow suit. I feel like we're operationally so distinct that I actually don't think about it that way. And I guess for that reason, it's hard for me to think in the way that you do about, like, what, or in the way that localism scholars sometimes do about, like, what should be local. Mm-hmm. It's more like, well, what is local? That's democratically driven. So how are you going to deal with it? So I actually end up returning back to Nestor's point of view. I don't actually think it's up to us. You know, what should we want to be local? It's, like, not up to us. You just catch what you catch, and then you address it. And so anyway, that's, I'll stop there. We can take a cue.
That's great, Ira.
Yeah, I would basically agree with those points, and just responding to two of your points, one on this question of whether there's a need to preserve the gap. I mean, you identified yourself as the federalist on your panel, and that question is, like, that's a federalist thinking.
Right.
Which is fine. It's not a question that I had even thought of, but I guess I would just say, along with Nestor and Kathleen, that it's, if nothing else, from a kind of incremental, pragmatic level, cities are stepping up because they want to and they have to, and there's a gap, and that's good, and that's enough.
There's either a gap or there's a disagreement, and
right.
That's what they're responding to.
Right.
And that also kind of goes to your second point about...
Can you speak to the microphone?
sorry, that goes to your second point about whether cities are too vulnerable. But I think if you pushed me hard enough, I might be willing to entertain a case for a kind of privacy exceptionalism here. Because what's really interesting about privacy is that, I'll go out on a limb and make this claim, looking at Joel, if you can correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think there's, with one minor exception that I'm happy to explain away, there's no known case of a federal law forcing a state or local government to lower its standards. Mm-hmm. So that the notion that, isn't it vulnerable? Well, yeah, it's vulnerable, but it's not vulnerable to getting forced down. Mm-hmm. There's a floor, cities do more, nobody's gonna tell them to do less. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's, you know, I don't know enough to say if that's truly unique to privacy, but it's something different about privacy. So that doesn't concern me quite as much as it might in the abstract.
Great, all right, well, I recognize we're somewhat on the other side of time, but let's see if we can keep the following to maybe 5 minutes or so. So let's start with Joel.
So this is probably directed mostly at Nestor and Ira. I think you made the very convincing argument that we're going to be seeing much more at the state level. It's inevitable. Ira, in your paper, you talked a little bit about the resource issue, state, the local level resource issue. And I wonder how the two of you would see the role that plays and how we rely on local government to help in the privacy space. So I can think, for example, of two examples. One is in the edtech space, where local schools are dealing with a lot of local information about their children. They're utterly clueless on how to deal with the technology. They just don't have the staff. Here in New York City, when we had a really interesting case involving the Taxi and Limousine Commission seeking GPS data from rideshare programs, it seemed to me that the staff at the TLC had no clue. They were so oblivious to what some of the privacy implications were. How should that play into your thinking about it? Because I think at the local level, you know, the federal government has a hard enough time hiring technologists and lawyers who understand this. At the local level, it's going to be even more pronounced. So how might that play into what we should be thinking of for the appropriate activity at the local level?
So I have a couple of thoughts there. One is to borrow an idea from Catherine Crump. We could have the federal government playing a role here by including requirements in funding grants to cities for the purchase of surveillance technology, that part of the grant money be used for developing privacy programs. Now, politically, that may or may not be feasible, and the people who sponsor those kind of programs may not support this, but that would be one way to ensure that this is not only, you know, part of the program, but even has some funding behind it. The point I made earlier about federal regulatory programs was more of an observation about existing structures, not some, you know, an inherent characteristic of things. So that could change. That would be one way to go about it. The other thing that occurs to me is to try to borrow from some federal models. These federal models have their own problems, and then they'd have additional problems being transported into the local setting, but they're still worth considering. One is to have cities stand up boards that are somewhat analogous to the PCLOB, to the Privacy Civil Liberties Oversight Board, which does sort of a general look at technologies and makes broad recommendations. Oakland has something like that with the Oakland Privacy Commission, and I think that would be useful in other cities as well. You have questions about funding and resources, but that would help develop some expertise and shift some of the burden away from the legislature in the locales. And then you also have the model, again, somewhat problematic, of the multi-stakeholder groups that the Obama administration stood up. And what I'm thinking there is, if cities convene these multi-stakeholder groups to make some broader decisions about surveillance technologies, then you could look at individual cases against existing best practice guidelines. So rather than each technology requiring its own detailed review and application and submission to the council, et cetera, you could say, oh, this is a technology, we're using it, but we're following the guidelines we've already all agreed upon, and that might streamline the process.
Nestor, did you also want to respond before we go on?
I don't have much to add to that. I think that's all great. I mean, the two things I would say is I have a bit more faith that once this is on everyone's radar, the mechanisms of policy diffusion will actually begin to work. I don't think it has been enough. So I think, you know, the work you're doing in EdTech, the work that, that others are doing, actually can put resources on the table that local governments will then, I think, absorb more rapidly than perhaps your question suggested. The other thing I would say is that, going back to the kind of intertwining of public and private, I think there's a role for the private sector to play to the extent that they're on the receiving end of data requests to actually help educate the public sector and be an advocate. And that gets back to the sort of multi-stakeholder, but also a very practical way in which this comes up in franchising of cable companies. There are lots of ways in which the local government interacts directly with the private sector, and I think there can be a role to the extent that the private sector is taking privacy seriously and they're thinking about their customers for private sector advocacy here as well.
Okay, we have two questions. We're going to go to the gentleman in the white shirt in the corner.
I mean, I guess all I would say is that seems like a really strong argument. Both of those seem like a really strong argument for privacy localism. That if we're worried about capacity and we're worried about knowledge and we're worried about engagement, that's exactly the conversation we need to be having at the local level, because the local governments are not going to collect any less data. There are really unique privacy concerns that play out at the local level. We didn't really talk about it very much, but there's a nice section in Ira's paper where he talks about the kind of panopticon you get at the local level you don't really get when you think about national level, where they're there, but they're much more concentrated when you think about the ability of various local agencies and local officials to kind of collect lots and lots and lots of information about us across silos, right? So all your comments lead me to think we really need, there's a much greater urgency about figuring out the right approach at the local level than at the state and national level, as important as those questions are.
Okay, we have one more question. The gentleman in the purple shirt.
Sure, I'll limit it to one. So talking a little bit about the democratic role of the local government, but of course, privacy harms often go to minority communities, even within the local area, where you know the majority might well be happy with ALPR use of the local mosque or using Twitter surveillance of Black Lives Matter. How do we think about the role of minority communities within all the different levels of democracy and how we protect their interests while we're thinking about privacy localism?
You're throwing that one to me?
Yeah, well, you're the democracy expert here. This is a democracy failure question.
Right. I think this question of democracy and minorities is so interesting right now because it feels as though, I mean, Heather Gerken has written about this and other people have written about this, it feels as though we're in an upside down world where, you know, we used to turn to the federal government for minority protections and we were really, really worried about local governments as sites for abuse of the minority by a majority. And that doesn't really feel like the dynamic right now. So I think that's one point. The other point is that it feels like something is shifting and has been, at least in San Francisco and Oakland, the places that I'm familiar with, which is that organizations, you know, nonprofit organizations that represent minority interests that typically think of local governments as the enemy are starting to see local governments, because they're moving in a more progressive direction as they grow, as potential allies in the enforcement of the rights of minorities. And so I saw this in, you know, my work in the sort of gay rights arena on behalf of San Francisco, and also in the women's health arena on behalf of San Francisco. And it was so interesting to suddenly find myself in the room with people who would see the city and county of San Francisco sign, you know, thing on my badge, and say, oh, that's the enemy, why don't you go sit over there? And I'd say, well, actually, I just filed the marriage equality case, right? So there's, in the same way that maybe, like when I started out, I was a labor lawyer, and in the same way that labor unions in, like, let's say the 80s, started to be seen by nonprofit groups as potential partners and platforms for progressive change, and not just people who bargain at the negotiating table for you, but like possible partners with environmental groups, possible partners with minority groups, possible partners with women's groups. I suspect that as politics, as cities grow and become potentially more progressive because of growth, because of just physical growth, that what you're going to end up seeing is partnerships between progressive groups and local governments. And they have to work out. What's interesting about that is that you end up sometimes being in the same room with groups on the defense side for a city and on the offense side for the city on the, in the other case. So then you, it becomes very confusing, right? But at least then you're at least in the same room, and you see yourselves as trying to sort of solve the same problems as opposed to on opposite sides of the fence. So I hope that these partnerships will continue to flourish. And I've also, in response to that question, I actually have written recently about a tripartite relationship between nonprofit organizations, city and county law offices, and law schools. Because I feel like law schools are actually sites for education about how the rule of law protects minorities. So I see that as like a holy trinity of kind of collaboration that would strengthen from the ground up the kinds of principles that you've touched upon.
Okay, well, there's obviously a lot more to say, but I think we're going to wrap it up there. We're going to take a coffee break now of 10 minutes, and we'll reconvene in here at 5 minutes to. Thank you.
I just want to thank also all the speakers.
Sorry.